Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent and merciful, I welcome you all in our today's session. Today we'll be talking about ethics, justice, and fair treatment in HR management. And along with that, there are a few other topics we'll be covering as well, which would be in support of our overall discussion. So let's start our today's talk. And first of all, we'll be talking about ethics. When we think about ethics, we are concerned with the principles of conduct governing an individual or a group. Specifically, the standards you use to decide what your conduct should be. Secondly, ethical behavior depends on the person's frame of reference. Ethics, technically speaking, would define the difference between right and wrong. It would be guiding us that what we should be doing and what we should not be doing. Ethics mostly depend upon values. And there are four sources of value systems. The first one is religion. The second source of value system would be doctrine, or we can also call it as isms. The third source is the environment. And the fourth source of value system would be the genetic makeup. When we talk about religion, for example, Islam, Christianity, we are concerned with the word of God, that what God has revealed upon us, what we have to follow and obey, what are the guidelines, what are the principles of conduct, how should we behave? So our frame of reference is the word of God. When we talk about doctrines or isms, these are man-made philosophies. These are man-made interpretations of the realities. For example, capitalism, socialism, dialectic materialism. So there are so many philosophies around us, which would again guide us and which would be providing us the principles of conduct and deciding upon our behaviors. But in that case, the frame of reference would not be the word of God. It would be the meanings derived from realities, and the meanings are derived by human. The third source of value system would be the environment in which we develop, we progress. Our parents, teachers, our home, our schools, institutions we belong to, our society, the culture in which we live. So the overall physical context of the environment in which we survive would also be setting norms and values for us, would always be sorting out the principles of conduct and the modes of behavior. And the fourth source of values would be the genetic makeup, the genes, the DNA strand, which would not just carry the color of our eyes and the length of our hair, but the genes can also carry the values. As it is said in the Holy Quran by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا, that we have given intuition to the man so that he can create the difference between the right and wrong. So our genetic makeup would always be creating the sixth sense for us, our own intuitional context in which we'll be interpreting the things, we'll be devising the principles of conduct for us, and eventually our behavior would also be influenced by our perceptions, our own perceptions, and the interpretations. So when we talk about ethics, we should be very much clear that what is our frame of reference and how that frame of reference is guiding our lives, is providing us the basis for decision making, and how we should be treating with others, and what should be the accepted conduct which can create a win-win situation for all of us. There are certain factors which are affecting ethical decisions. For example, when we talk about normative judgments, it would mean judging something as good or bad, right or wrong, better or worse. And when we talk about moral standards or morality, it would mean society's accepted standards for behaviors that have serious consequences to its well-being. And the moral standards would also be talking about the behaviors that cannot be established or changed by decisions of authoritative bodies, and the behaviors that override self-interest. So they'll be counted as moral standards. In the further discussion, when we are talking about ethics and fair treatment at work, we also need to see the relationship of law with ethics. And there can be four situations. The first one is that behavior may be legal but unethical. The behavior may be illegal but ethical. The behavior may be both legal and ethical. And behavior may be both illegal and unethical. So these are the four situations in which the law and the ethics, they interact with each other. Because ethics are not purely based upon the law. No doubt, the law is developed to govern the societies, to establish the standard code of conduct. But again, the ethics can always be over and above the law. Now, when we talk about justice, there are different types of justice. The first one is distributive justice, which would mean the fairness and justice of a decision's result. The second can be procedural justice, which would mean the fairness of the process by which the decision was reached. And the third one is interactional justice, which is also known as interpersonal justice, which would mean the manner in which managers conduct their interpersonal dealings with employees. Now, when we talk about behavior at work, we need to see that how ethics are involved at workplace. So for that, the first important thing is individual factors. And in individual factors, other than their personality, and as we defined earlier, other than their KSAOs, we also need to see that from where they have derived their value systems. The second would be organizational factors, which would be related to the resources, the culture, the overall organizational structure, the environment in which organization is operating. Then there would be the boss's influence. And obviously, the boss's influence would be derived from the value system he or she would be following. Ethics and policies, which are developed, the codes of conduct which are developed in the organization, formally documented in documented form. Then overall organization's culture, how much they are risk-taking, how much they are risk-averse, how much they pay attention to detail, how much aggressive they are, or they are cooperative with one another or not. Are they people-oriented or outcome-oriented? So the different dimensions of culture would also be discussed. So when we talk about employees and ethical dilemmas, the questions employees ask or should ask when faced with ethical dilemmas would be that, is the action legal? Is it right to do it or not? Who will be affected? Does it fit the company's values? How will it feel afterwards? How will it look in the newspaper? Will it reflect poorly on the company? So we should be conscious about different pros and cons, that when, why, how we are going to follow particular behavioral context. And through that particular behavioral context, we have to be careful that how it is going to impact upon the stakeholders and other parties involved. When we talk about organizational culture, the organizational culture would comprise of the characteristics driven by values, traditions, behaviors, and the company's employees share, their dependency relationships. How is culture revealed when we do the cultural studies, then we investigate the culture. It would be revealed through ceremonial events, written rules and spoken commands, office layout, organizational structure, which would also include the departmentalization, the hierarchy, and obviously the physical outlook of the company as well, the dress codes they are following, cultural symbols and behaviors, who is the figurehead, who is the leader in the organization, because obviously the figurehead and the leader would be there to lead the values and would be there to reinforce the ethics in the organization. So let's look at the manager's role in creating culture. The first role is that he or she has to clearly define the expectations for values to be followed. Use signs and symbols to signal the importance of values. Provide physical support for values, which would be in form of rewards. Use stories to illustrate values and organize rites and ceremonies reinforcing values. So these are the manager's role in creating an ethical culture. Now let's look at the HR's role in forecasting ethics and fair treatment. The first question we need to address is, why treat employees fairly? Because remember, the employees you have hired, they are not just employees, they are people too. And that statement was given by the management guru, Peter F. Drucker, who emphasized that we should be able to keep separate the people from the problem. We should be able to deal with the people rather than we should be dealing with employees as a component in the system. So, why treat employees fairly? It is said that we should be able to avoid employee litigation. We should be able to enhance employee commitment. We should be there to enhance satisfaction with the organization, with jobs and with leaders. And obviously, increased organizational citizenship behaviors are the reasons that why we should treat employees fairly. So when we talk about HR ethics activities, let's start from staffing and selection. And in that context, fostering the perception of fairness in the process of recruitment and hiring of people. So for that, there should be formal procedures. Interpersonal treatment should be fair and fine and based upon justice. And we should be able to provide explanations for our actions. When we are concerned with training, we need to look at how to recognize ethical dilemmas, how to use ethical frameworks such as codes of conduct to resolve problems, and how to use HR functions such as interviews and disciplinary practices in ethical ways. When we talk about performance appraisal, remember that appraisals that make it clear the company adheres to high ethical standards by marrying and rewarding employees who follow those standards is the best way to judge people. So appraisals should always be, again, based upon ethical standards and ethical merit of evaluation. When we are concerned with reward and disciplinary systems, Your author of the book says that the organization swiftly and harshly punishes unethical conduct. So any person who is violating the rules, regulations, and policies, who is violating the discipline, who is not ethical, should be sorted out. And obviously, when we are concerned with workplace aggression and violence, it is said that taking care that HR actions do not foster perceptions of inequalities that translate into dysfunctional behaviors by employees. Now, for all this, we need to build two-way communication, and the perceptions of fair treatment depends on engagement, explanation, and expectation clarity. Now let's define these three terms one by one. When we say engagement, it means involving individuals in the decisions that affect them by asking for their input and allowing them to refute the merits of others' ideas and assumptions. When we are concerned with explanation, it is said ensuring that everyone involved and affected understands why final decisions are made and the thinking that underlies the decisions. And when we are talking about expectation clarity, it means making sure everyone knows upfront by what standards they will be judged and the penalties for failure. So these are the three most important things which would be there to develop the perceptions of fair treatment. Now, looking at employee discipline and privacy, we need to talk about the basis for a fair and just discipline process. And for that, there should be clear rules and regulations. And we'll be able to define workplace issues and inform employees accordingly. A system of progressive penalties should always be defined and discussed. So the range and severity of the penalty is a function of the offense and number of occurrences. And remember that there should always be an appeals process as well, which gives the right of the employees to grieve the decision, helps to ensure that supervisors mete out discipline fairly and equitably. So there should not be injustice with anyone. And obviously, as we have talked about justice, we have to maintain distributive justice, procedural justice, and interactionist justice, all three at the same time. Now, when you are disciplining an employee, we have to bear in mind that does the facts support the charge of employee wrongdoing? Were the employee's due process rights protected? Was the employee warned of disciplinary consequences? Was a rule violated? And was it reasonably related to the efficient and safe operation of the work environment? Was the matter fairly and adequately investigated before administering discipline? Did the investigation produce substantial evidence of misconduct? We should always be concerned with the rules, orders, and penalties which are being applied even-handedly. We should be looking that is the penalty reasonably related to the misconduct and to the employee's past work history. We should also always be concerned with the employee and considering that did the employee have the right to counsel. We need to see, did anger, hearsay, which means rumors, or personal impressions affect the decision? So remember, when we have to discipline without punishment, there are certain non-punitive disciplinary actions. The first can be issue an oral reminder. Second, should another incident arise within 6 weeks, issue a formal written reminder, a copy of which is placed in the employee's personal file. Three, give a paid 1 day decision-making leave so that the person can relax and think about his or her conduct and future course of action. The fourth, if no further incidents occur in the next year, the 1 day paid suspension from the person's file. If the behavior is repeated, the next step is dismissal. Now, talking about employee privacy, remember that employee privacy violations upheld by the courts, which would involve, number one, intrusion, which is locker room and bathroom surveillance. It can include publication of private matters. It can have disclosure of medical records. And in addition to that, appropriation of an employee's name or likeness. Now, there are certain actions triggering privacy violations, which would include background checks, monitoring off-duty conduct and lifestyle, drug testing, workplace searches, monitoring of workplace. And remember, before launching any of these actions, you should be clear about the law and you should be clear about the reason for which you are doing it. Talking further in terms of employee privacy, what do employers monitor about employees? They can go for monitoring of email activity, internet use, telephone calls. And employers monitor employees to improve productivity, protect from computer viruses, detect leaks of confidential information. And obviously, there can be a guard against liability for legal acts and harassment suits caused by employee misuse. There are certain restrictions on the workplace monitoring, and that may include the Electronic Communications Privacy Act, which is no doubt defined in terms of American society. But Electronic Communication Privacy Act also has its implications in Pakistani environment as well. And again, remember that one must be very much careful about the law and the reason for which such workplace monitoring is required. So the business purpose exemption permits employers to monitor communications if they can show a legitimate business reason for doing so. And the consent exception allows employers to monitor communications if they have their employees' consent to do so. So, these are the common laws which provide protection against invasion of privacy. Now let's talk about managing dismissals. When we say dismissal, it would mean involuntary termination of an employee's employment with the firm. And remember, when we say terminate at will rule, it would mean without a contract, the employee can resign for any reason at will, and the employer can similarly dismiss the employee for any reason or no reason at will. So limitations on the termination related to will, termed as terminate at will, would include violation of public, implied contract, and good faith concerns. Now, when we talk about limitations on termination, and the term goes like terminate at will, as we said, that public policy exception we need to look at, which we'll be talking about, discharge is wrongful when it was against an explicit, well-established public policy, employee fired or refusing to break the law. The second can be implied contract exception, which means employer statements about future employment create a contractual obligation for the employer to continue to employ the employee. And when we are talking about good faith, so covenant of good faith exception would include suggestions that employers should not fire employees without good cause. Now let's look at the grounds for dismissal. There can be unsatisfactory performance, which means persistent failure to perform assigned duties or to meet prescribed standards on the job. It can be misconduct in the workplace, which means deliberate or willful violations of the employer's rules, stealing, rowdy behavior, and insubordination. It can be lack of qualifications for the job, as an employee's inability to do the assigned work, although he or she is diligent. And it can also be changed requirements for elimination of the job, in which an employee's inability to do the work assigned after the nature of the job has changed can be counted. And it can also include elimination of the employee's job. Now let's look at insubordination. Insubordination would be caused because of direct disregard of the boss authority, flat out disobedience of or refusal to obey the boss orders, particularly in front of others, deliberate defiance of clearly stated company policies, rules, regulations, and procedures, public criticism of the boss, contracting or arguing with him or her is also negative and inappropriate. Blatant disregard of reasonable instructions. Contemptuous display of disrespect and portraying these feelings while on the job. Disregard for the chain of command shown by going around the immediate supervisor or manager with a complaint, suggestion, or political maneuver. Participation in or leadership of an effort to undermine and remove the boss from power. These can be the reasons for insubordination. We'll be talking about managing dismissal in our second session. Please hurry up to join.